All right, so at the end of the last class, we were looking at, let me just get the projection going first. Okay, so at the end of the last class, we were looking at the problem of scaling, right? So what is it exactly that we are talking about when we talk about generations of technology and the transistor scaling as we go through the years, right? So essentially we said we started off with something like feature sizes which were many microns in width. Then it came down progressively, typically by a factor of 2 every 1.5 to 2 years, right? At the stage at which we are considering this course, it is 180 nanometers or 0.18 microns. After that, the scaling continued. It went down to 130 nanometers, then 90, 65, 45, and it has continued, right? So typically nowadays, the common technologies that you would find would be somewhere in the region of 28 or 22 nanometers. Typically probably 28 for most of the SoCs, right? So you might actually see that your mobile phones talk about some Qualcomm Snapdragon processor made in a 28 nanometer technology, right? So they want to show that it's sort of cutting edge. It's the latest and greatest technology. Of course, nowadays Intel and IBM are making things at probably 14 nanometers, right? Actually manufacturing test devices they have at 10 and even 7 nanometers. Think about it, 7 nanometer transistors, right? We were talking about gate thickness, gate oxide thickness of 4 nanometers, right? And you're getting to a point where your transistor length, the entire L for the transistor is now reaching 10 nanometers or so, okay? So at those scales, other issues do come in that we need to worry about. We need to change the way that the transistors are made. We cannot use the same lithography processes anymore, right? Lots of issues come up, but the reason why we are sticking to 180 over here is because most of the fundamental principles in terms of design are already sort of brought up at this scale. And it becomes easier to sort of explain it at this level and then sort of say, okay, these are the differences as you go to smaller technologies as and when we get to them, okay? So what I'm going to do now is quickly sort of put down a list of items that change as a result of scaling, right? And also look at two possible different methods of scaling that we have typically and consider what would be the impact on each of those parameters under each of those types of scaling, right? So the two types of scaling that we are going to look at, right? So what do I mean by scaling over here? What are all the parameters that scale? First is all length related parameters. So this is essentially the lambda, right? The scaling factor that we talked about, okay? There is one particular parameter called lambda, which is used in order to sort of describe the minimum feature size. Well, 2 lambda is the minimum feature size in a typical technology. And all lengths and widths are then expressed as multiples of that lambda, right? So by the way, one other thing which was not sort of, I think, demonstrated by the TAs, but you can also look it up on your own. When you're writing SPICE decks, right? By the way, the SPICE file is called a SPICE deck for historical reasons, right? When you're writing a SPICE deck, you can, instead of sort of giving lengths as 0.18U, 0.36U and so on, which is directly in microns, you can declare a separate parameter called lambda and set the lambda equal to 0.09 microns or 90 nanometers and then express all your lengths, areas and so on in multiples of that lambda or lambda square as the case may be, okay? So that makes it a little easier to sort of, you don't have to worry about multiplying it and making sure whether you have got 0.18 microns correctly multiplied or not. You just express it as 2 lambda, 4 lambda and so on. Okay. So that's something you can do. It is purely optional, which is why we are not sort of insisting on it. It does make your life a little bit easier. So I would suggest you look at those features and try to use them while writing your SPICE files. So anyway, this lambda is the main parameter that determines all length related. Well, not all, the length and width of the transistor. There is also the thickness of the oxide, which we are going to consider as also scaling as a length parameter, okay? Apart from this, there is one other parameter which is important to the functioning of the, or rather, another set of parameters which is important to the functioning of the transistors. These are the voltages. Primarily VDD and VT. Okay. So the question becomes, when you are scaling a circuit, what do we mean by the scaling, right? So the first thing, of course, is we are talking about scaling the lengths of all the parameters. Apart from that, we also have the option of scaling the voltage at which it is operating. Okay. Because of that, we end up with two types of scaling. One of them is called full scaling, and the other one is called fixed voltage scaling. Okay. So let's look at what are all the parameters that we are interested in, right? And what is the impact of each of these two types of scaling on those parameters. Okay. So first I'll put down a list of the parameters that we are possibly interested in, and then we'll sort of list out how they are impacted by these scaling scaling factors. Right. So the first, of course, is W, L, and Tx. Okay. These are the length parameters. Then comes VDD and VT. These are the voltage parameters. After that come a number of sort of derived or derivative parameters which you can derive from the equations that we already have for governing these things. An example is the area. Okay. The oxide capacitance per unit area, Cox. The total gate capacitance, which is basically Cox into WL. Okay. The K parameters, the K, N, and P, right, which is basically Cox W by L, or rather mu Cox W by L, right. Then there is the saturation current. Okay, we'll consider velocity saturation since most of the things that we are interested in, the scaling regimes that we are interested in, are already velocity saturated. But you can sort of, you know, figure out similar equations for the regular saturation as well, the level one equations. The current density, right, which is basically the current per unit area. The effective on resistance of the transistor, right. The power dissipated by the transistor and the power density. Okay, so these are the primary parameters that we are going to look at and sort of see how each of them is influenced by the scaling factors that we apply. Okay, why these? Because each of these has a direct impact on the performance of the transistor. The current, for example, determines how fast you can switch. The power determines how much power is dissipated in the circuit. We have not got to that yet, but at least we can get a rough idea of how much power is likely to be dissipated in the circuit just based on the overall parameters, right, the voltage and some currents. The power density in turn tells us how easy is it to sort of, you know, if the power density keeps on increasing, we have other issues. The thing starts getting hotter and hotter because there's too much power being dissipated in a given area, right? So there are some issues of that sort that need to be considered, and these parameters, if we can sort of see how they are affected by scaling, that will help us to understand that better. Okay. All right. So now let's look at each of these things under full scaling, and the second option, like I said, is fixed voltage scaling. So the first two lines will basically illustrate exactly what we mean by that. In WL Tx, whether we are talking about full scaling or fixed voltage scaling, we are assuming that from one generation to the next, these parameters WL and Tx go down by a factor of 1 by S. Right? Obviously over here S is greater than 1. Okay. So 1 by s is the scaling parameter, right? When you go from 180 nanometers to 130 nanometers, s is about root 2. So 1 over root 2, 0.7 is that scaling parameter which is being applied. Okay. So in other words, the length, all the length parameters decrease by a certain amount. Right. So this is the same whether it's full scaling or fixed voltage scaling. The next one, obviously, the difference is where comes over here as far as VDD and VT is concerned. In full scaling, we assume that the VDD and VT also scale down by exactly the same parameter. Okay. But in fixed voltage scaling, obviously, they do not. Okay. So the scaling factor is just one. They remain constant. Okay. Now the question arises, why would you want to do this, right? Why would you do fixed voltage scaling instead of full scaling? That comes about because of other parameters, I mean other issues, right? As you scale your supply voltage and your threshold voltage down, we'll look at it later once we look at the CMOS inverter in more detail. The noise margin, the how robust your circuits are to certain amount of noise, reduces. So there will be conditions in which you feel that, you know, you can no longer reduce your supply voltage or your threshold voltage without sort of negatively impacting the behavior of your circuit. So then what do? You try and keep the voltage higher than it would be if, when you apply scaling, or preferably you try to keep it completely fixed. Okay. Now what that means is there is also another form of scaling that can come in between these two, which is sometimes called general scaling or generalized scaling, where what we say is the length parameter is reduced by this factor S, the voltage parameter is reduced by some other factor, we will call it U, and then take both of those parameters into account while trying to find out the net effect of the scale, right? I'm not going into that at the moment. But if you want, you can always apply those things as well and see what impact it has. It's also discussed in the book by Rabbi and Jamhas. Okay. All right. So let's start looking at the rest of the parameters that we were considering. First was area. Under full scaling, how does the area go? 1 by S square, right? Because W and L both have gone 1 by S. Fixed voltage scaling, same. Okay, C aux is epsilon aux by T aux, right? It's the per unit area capacitance. How does this scale? It goes up by a factor of S. Okay, in both cases, it's not dependent on voltage. What about the total gate capacitance? 1 by S, right? Why? It's the C aux multiplied by the area. Okay. Now the Kn and Kp parameters. The mu, how does that scale? We don't know. We have not discussed it so far, right? But it's primarily a technology related parameter. It has nothing to do directly with the lengths or widths of the transistors. So at a first cut, we can sort of assume that it's a constant. Okay? Which means basically that it goes as mu n C aux into W by L. Right? Mu n is a constant, C aux goes as S, W by L, the effects cancel out. Okay? So this Kn and Kp parameters also go up by this factor S. Okay. What about the saturation current? We are talking about velocity saturation, right? In velocity saturation, this current is essentially determined by the parameters C aux, W, and the voltage, right? C aux W by L into mu V by L, right? So effectively, the net thing that happens is it becomes proportional to mu C aux, well, no, C aux W into V. Those are the parameters that determine it. Okay? If we take the entire equation into account. What this means is under conditions of full scaling, C aux goes up by a factor of S, W goes down by a factor of S, V goes down by a factor of S. okay, 1 over s. But here is the first place where you have a difference. In fixed voltage scaling, the saturation current, effectively what it's saying is my voltage has not scaled down with the technology. So I'm applying a higher voltage for a given technology. What do I expect? A higher current. Okay. C aux W, they cancel out. V remains constant. So the saturation current, in other words, pretty much remains constant as you go from one generation to the next. Okay. But what does that mean for current density? That's the density per unit area. Right? This goes up by a factor of S over here and S square over here. Okay. So this is actually problematic in the case of fixed voltage scaling. Effectively what it's telling us that the current density is sort of doubling on every generation. Right? The amount of current that has to flow through a given area is increasing very sharply. You can see how that could cause problems. You are talking about more and more current in very, very tiny areas, right? That has impact on heat, the sheer ability of the carriers to carry that much current, and so on. So clearly this is not very realistic, right? Or at least we don't expect it to be realistic across many generations of scaling. But this is what happens if we were to apply this kind of scaling. The reality is going to be somewhere in between these two, in between full scaling and fixed voltage scaling. Right? But the important point is, in either case, the current density sort of does increase on each generation. R on, right? This is essentially what 3/4 VDD by ISAT, right? VDD scales, ISAT scales. So R on pretty much remains constant. In the case of fixed voltage scaling, VDD remains the same, ISAT also remains the same. Once again, R on remains constant. Okay, and the last two parameters are the power, which I'm going to approximate as V times ISAT. Right? V scales as 1 over S, ISAT also as 1 over S. The power goes down by this. Okay? So in other words, what it's telling you is, if you were to scale the entire technology and also scale the supply voltage, the total power would essentially halve on each generation. Exactly the same circuit. You shrink it, reduce the power, reduce the voltage supply. The power dissipation reduces. Right? But you shrink it and don't reduce the voltage supply, power remains a constant. Because the V and ISAT effects, well, neither of them is scaling. Okay? Remember, this is a very crude approximation. Why? Because the ISAT itself, we have assumed, is just the velocity saturation current. Strictly speaking, that's not completely true, because we are going through a number of different regions. Okay? Is it always velocity saturated? No. There will be some transitions that are happening over there. Okay? The other thing is, you know, we are sort of taking V into ISAT. That's not really what the power consumption is going to be. It's going to be determined by some other parameters. But this gives us a first order approximation of what we can expect to see. Okay? And the last parameter is the power density, which is essentially power per unit area. Here it becomes constant. Here it goes as S square. Okay? Now, for a long time, many generations of technology, full scaling was what was applied. Okay? So if you go back and look at the books also, you will see that at the time of, let's say, 0.5 micron technology, the supply voltages used were 5 volts. 0.35 micron technology, it was 3.3 volts. Okay? 0.25 micron technology, 2.5 volts. 0.18, 1.8 volts. 0.13, 1.2 volts. Okay? So it has scaled across several generations. But after that, it stagnated. When you went to 90 nanometer, 65 nanometer, you would expect the voltage to drop below 1 volt. It did not. Because primarily of the secondary effects, right? The moment you hit that, then you start seeing things like your noise margins are not good enough. you are no longer able to scale the way that you wanted to. If you bring down your supply voltage and you bring down your threshold voltage, your circuits are no longer as robust as you wanted them to be. Okay? So somewhere around 2006 or so, if you look at it, is where this transition started becoming prominent. It was there even before. It was not that it was a pure scaling that applied and in 2006 everybody gave up and said we can't do this anymore. It sort of gradually happened, but that's sort of when the transition more or less became significant. Okay, so this left hand regime is sometimes also called Dennard scaling. Right, or constant power density scaling. Right, so you keep the power density constant and you scale. It's called Dennard scaling after the person who first sort of observed it and said that this is one way in which you expect circuits to scale and that these are how the different parameters behave. Okay, right now we are in a regime which is somewhere in between full scaling and fixed voltage scaling, probably shifting more towards the fixed voltage than to full scaling. Okay, but every now and then there is some technological change which allows you to either operate at a lower voltage or some other condition which essentially says, okay, the scaling is different from what you expect. So now you can no longer just blindly apply these rules and predict what's going to happen, but they give you a good feel for what is actually happening. Okay, all right. So that's just a quick summary, a sort of digression into the area of scaling. Right, what we are going to do now is to look at, yeah, sure, yes, yes. Yes. Yeah, so it will be mu and Cox, W by L, VD sat, VGS minus VT minus VD sat. Two of those cancel out, right? So the VGS minus VT minus VD sat also scales, the VD sat also scales, the L also scales. So one of those cancels with the L. The reason I'm writing it as Cox WV is because of how it was actually originally derived, right? The Cox WL into W into V sort of gives you the current, not the charge per unit length of the channel, right? And that multiplied by the velocity of the electrons is the current. Okay, so Cox WV, you can think of it this way. This is something that we did not sort of look at while talking about velocity saturation, but if I look at the current which is there under one strip over here, right, effectively I can think of this as Cox into W into V. Okay, this is a charge per unit length of channel. Okay, so this Q by L, so to say, multiplied by the velocity of the electrons is going to be the current. In velocity saturation, what we are saying is this is a constant. Right? Now, in turn, we then brought that in as a VD sat by L as the electric field multiplied by the mu n and so on. So VD sat by L, effectively what we are saying is that is a constant, which is why I sort of left that parameter out completely and said that the current is going to be proportional to Cox WV, where V is the VGS minus VT minus VD sat by L. VD sat is also scaled. I mean, well, so VD sat is, VD sat by L is a constant effectively. Correct. No, no. So that's what I'm telling you. When you're talking about the saturation current, right? What is the saturation current? It's going to be given by I sat is equal to mu Cox WV. This is the charge per unit length multiplied by the velocity of the electrons. Okay? This velocity of the electrons is, sorry, mu into VD sat by L. But this entire thing is a constant. So this is the parameter that determines the ISAT in velocity saturation. Yeah, so that's what I'm trying to tell you. VE is a constant. That's the definition of velocity saturation. We write it as mu n into VD sat by L because we want an expression in terms of VD sat and L and so on. In reality, this VD sat by L should not be there. It should be replaced by the critical field, electric field, which is constant across technologies. Okay, so actually speaking, the VD sat by L is going to be constant across technologies because the electric field, the critical electric field at which the electron velocity saturates, is going to be constant across technologies. Okay, so that's the other thing. All right, so we are now going to look at delays, right? Delays through circuit elements, with a primary focus on how we understand, how we will need to understand the propagation delay through a gate once we implement gates. We have not yet got to the point of actually implementing gates, but we are sort of jumping ahead and seeing how do you define a delay through a gate and how do you measure it, right? So we already have the SPICE assignment which covers that, which is why I'm also going to go into it now itself. Okay, all right, so what we are saying is, let's consider a simple circuit like this. There is a switch, there is a resistance, there is a capacitance. I am considering this point, the voltage across the capacitance, as my output voltage. The switch is closed at t equal to 0. Okay? And I want to know what happens to the output voltage as a function of time, and in turn, how do I define something which can be measured as a propagation delay through this circuit? Okay, so what happens once I close the switch at time t equal to 0? What can you say about the equation V naught, about the voltage V naught? How is it going to be related to V? It's going to be an exponential rise, right? This is a simple RC circuit, right? So what happens is, once you close that switch initially, right, you cannot have an abrupt change in voltage across the capacitor because dV by dt cannot be infinity, right? So because of that, whatever voltage drops across the resistor that causes the current to flow into that resistor, the capacitor voltage starts changing at that rate. That in turn changes the current through the resistor and so on. They impact each other. Finally, when you solve the equation, you come up with something like this. V naught is equal to V, the supply voltage, into 1 minus e to the power of minus t by RC. Okay. So put in the values, when t is equal to 0, V naught is equal to V into 1 minus 1. So basically, V naught is equal to 0. As t tends to infinity, the e power minus t by RC term goes to 0, and V naught goes to V. Not V naught, I mean, I should call it VO, the V output. Okay, V naught can be confusing, it looks more like an initial voltage. Okay, so VO goes to V as t tends to infinity. So the curve would look something like this. Okay. So what we would like to do is define a couple of parameters over here which are of interest to us. Okay. The first parameter is, at what point does this voltage hit 50% of its final output value? Okay. Why am I interested in that 50% point? Because it's sort of, later on I will define propagation delays in terms of the 50% transition point. I'll sort of say that, you know, the input is transitioning, it hits 50% of its final value, the output also transitions, that hits 50% of the final value. What's the time difference between those two points? and I'll define that as my propagation delay. Okay, why 50%? It is somewhat arbitrary, but it makes sense simply because, as we will see later, the actual input transition is not going to be an abrupt switch closing at time t equal to 0. The input transition itself will take time for the voltage to build up from 0 to V. Okay, so if you take all of those effects into account, it is preferable to sort of work with that 50% transition point. So if we are interested in that, then effectively what we can say is, when does the voltage reach V by 2? Okay, so how do I solve that? I just plug it into the equation. V by 2 is equal to V into 1 minus e to the power of minus t by RC. Okay, rearrange terms, we get e power minus t by RC is equal to 1 by 2. Okay. Or in other words, take log, what we get is t by RC, or e power minus t by RC equal to 1 by 2 is the same as e power t by RC equals 2. Then take log, we get t by RC equal to natural log of 2, or t is equal to RC ln 2. Okay, it's approximately equal to 0.69 RC. So what does that tell us? The delay, the time required for this kind of a circuit, a simple first order RC circuit, to go from 0 up to 50% is proportional to the resistance and proportional to the capacitance. The constant of proportionality is just, you know, this parameter 0.69. Okay. So 0.69 or 0.7 RC is essentially used in order to indicate the 50% transition point. Okay. There is another parameter that is of interest to us, which is the rise time and correspondingly the fall time. Right? In particular, what we say is we will define something called the 10 to 90% rise, or sometimes you will find it some called the 20% to 80% rise. Depending on how you define it, obviously the number itself is going to change, right? So what does 10 to 90% rise mean? It says how much is the time difference between the point that the rising voltage reaches 10% of its final value versus 90% of its final value. Okay, so supposing the output was supposed to go from 0 to 1.8 volts, I'm saying the output starts rising, it reaches 0.18 volts, which is 10% of the final value. At that point, I start a timer. Okay? I wait until it hits 1.62 volts, that is 0.18 less than 1.8 volts, and stop the timer. That time difference tells me the 10 to 90% rise time. Okay? Why is that useful? It turns out this is actually a good parameter to keep in mind, because real circuits are not simple first order RCs. Okay? There will be some initial delay in the voltage even starting to rise. After that, there will be a rapid increase, and then there will be a tapering off as it reaches a certain value. Okay? So the actual shape that you get will not be a straightforward exponential. But this 10 to 90% gives it enough time for it to sort of accelerate, to pick up and start changing. And the 90% sort of, you know, says, okay, now I'm close enough to the final value, I don't need to worry about how long it takes to actually reach the final goal. Right? So we put some arbitrary limits. Like you can see here, right? 10 to 90% is arbitrary. Somebody else defines it as 20 to 80%. We are going to use 10 to 90%, just remain consistent with that number. Okay? This is called the rise time. Correspondingly, I can have a fall time. If the capacitor was initially charged and is then going to discharge, I'll have a fall time. So for example, that's what you need to do in part of the SPICE assignment, right? Measure the fall time through an NMOS transistor and see how well that matches against the first order RC. Okay. So what would this 10 to 90% rise time look like? The first voltage V1 is equal to 0.1 of V. This is equal to V into 1 minus e to the power of minus t by RC. The second one V2 is equal to 0.9 times V. This is V into 1 minus e to the minus t2 by RC. Okay. Rearrange the various terms. Finally, what we will get is rearrange and then finally do, you know, divide the two equations, right, one by the other. What I mean by rearrange is take all the e power minus t by RC terms one side, all the other things that are only dependent on V to the other side. That makes it easier to divide, and finally you get e to the power of t2 minus t1 by RC is going to be equal to 0.9V by 0.1V. Or in other words, is equal to 9. Okay, which means T2 minus T1 is equal to RC into ln of 9, which is approximately equal to 2.2 RC. Okay, so once again, the rise time, assuming a first order simple exponential curve like this, is proportional to R, it's proportional to C. Okay, the constant of proportionality is greater than the 0 to 50% rise time. That's understandable because you're going from 10% all the way up to 90%. The range is larger. Okay, and also after some time, the rate at which it changes is also slower. So finally, you end up with 2.2 RC as the number. Okay, so what this tells us, in other words, is we can actually define a 10% and 10% to 90% rise time and a 0 to 50% propagation delay in terms of these RC constants, assuming that the circuit can be approximated as a first order RC. In reality, that approximation is just that, it's an approximation, right? And you need to be careful how much weight you give to the numbers that you get from that approximation, right? That it turns out that for a lot of hand calculations and also for a lot of the optimizations that we need to do at the circuit level, that degree of detail is sufficient. Okay, that's good enough for us. Okay, so that's sort of the definitions of these numbers. The next thing that we need to know a little bit about before we go further into actually analyzing individual gates is what happens when you have a more complex network that is composed of R's and C's. Okay, an example of this is something which happens very often in circuits is that you will end up with a situation where I have, let's say, a NAND gate. The output of this needs to go to three other gates, right? One of them is an inverter, another one is another NAND gate, and the third one is, let's say, an XOR gate. Okay. Now, the question I'm going to ask you is, how much is the propagation delay or the rise time that I'm going to observe at this point? Okay. Or rather, more importantly, I want to know what is the delay from here to the output of this gate, from here to the output of this gate, or here to the output of this gate. Okay, I know that there is a certain time at which a transition occurs at the output of the NAND gate. I want to know how much time that will take to reflect at the output of the inverter, at the output of the second NAND gate, at the output of the XOR gate. Okay, now what this means is, we could do one simple approximation and say, okay, output at NAND gate changed at a certain time. I find out what is the delay through an inverter, add that number, and I get the output, you know, the transition time at the output of the inverter, right? Which would be okay, except for the fact that there are a couple of other issues also over here. The delay then depends on how much is the load capacitance due to that inverter. It also depends on the fact that there are, you know, other branching elements. The same NAND gate is also trying to deliver current to another NAND gate and an XOR gate. Okay, that will slow down how much, that will reduce the amount of current it can give to the inverter and therefore slow down the transition at the inverter. Okay, on top of that there are all these wires. Right now from the way I have drawn it, it looks as though the wire to the NAND gate is relatively long compared to the wire to the inverter. Does that matter? Right? It turns out that as we shrink the technology, it matters more and more. Right? And that influence of the wire is essentially something called the interconnect delay. Okay, the wiring over here is called the interconnect. Normally when we draw a boolean, a binary digital circuit, right, we only care about the gates that are there in the circuit. We don't care at all about the wires that are connecting them. We just assume that a wire is a connector and nothing more. But when you're actually designing circuits, you need to worry about that. You need to be concerned about the fact that there are wires. The wires themselves have a delay associated with them. Why do they have a delay? Because even a wire has a certain resistance associated with it. And not just that, think about what a wire is, right? In the case of silicon processors, I have a substrate, I have some insulating material, typically some insulating oxide, and on top of that I have a metal wire. So what does this remind you of? You have a conducting metal, you have an insulator, underneath it you have a substrate. Something similar is what we also observed in the case of a MOSFET, but in the MOSFET other things came into the picture, for example the source and drain terminals and so on. Right? We don't need to worry about those for a wire, but we still need to be concerned about the fact that there is a metal insulator conductor. In other words, a parallel plate capacitor. Okay? So this starts looking like a capacitor. Right? So every piece of metal that you put on the silicon material, right? Of course it's not directly put on the substrate, it is put on top of an insulating layer of silicon dioxide. Every such piece has a certain capacitance associated with it. The capacitance is usually much less than the capacitance of the transistor. Why? Why would the capacitance here be less than the capacitance of a transistor? I'm assuming that all of you have done a little bit about VLSI technology processing so far, right? You will need to have done that to understand this, but you can take a guess anyway. Why would the capacitance that is associated with the wire be less? How does the VLSI processing work? What is this insulator that I am talking about? Where does the insulator, why does it even come into the picture? Huh? Exactly. This insulator is something which is just put as a sort of protective layer on top of all the transistors and so on. After that comes the metal. What that means is it is much thicker than the TEOX. Okay? What happens when you have a thicker insulator? Smaller capacitance. Okay? So, the wire capacitances are typically smaller. The point is they are not negligible, primarily because even though transistors have scaled in a certain way, wires have not scaled in exactly the same fashion. So there are two oxides, right? When you are talking about VLSI processing, there is one TEOX which is the gate oxide. Then there is the field oxide which is used as an overall insulator on the other portions of the circuit. The gate oxide is 4 nanometers thick in the case of 180 nanometer technology. The field oxide is much thicker. It cannot be that thin, otherwise it would cause huge capacitance effects over there. Okay? Alright, so what's the point? What we are saying in other words is, if I have a wire, right, this essentially, the equivalent circuit model of this is some resistance and some capacitance going to ground. Why going to ground? Because it's essentially a capacitance between that wire and the substrate, which is the ground of the material. Okay. Of course, in reality, it's not as simple as this, because a long wire, if I just take its total resistance, its total capacitance and replace it with this, that's not really accurate. It turns out you need to do a slightly more complex model of this, right? Where you need to take the wire and break it up into small segments, consider the resistance and capacitance of each of those and see how they add. Okay. Long and short of it is, we are concerned about circuits which look like this. I have an input voltage point, okay, some place where a transition is occurring. According to this diagram, this would be the output of the NAND gate. Okay. From there, I have some resistance and I have some capacitance corresponding to that segment. It's one part of the wire. Then I have another segment of wire and another capacitance corresponding to that segment. Okay. Yet another resistance and the capacitance, let's say, corresponding to the inverter. Okay. Another resistance, capacitance over here. Another RC over here. Another RC over here. What are these? It could be possibly this corresponds to the inverter, this corresponds to the NAND gate, this corresponds to the XOR, this corresponds to wire. This is one possibility. Okay? It need not be. It could be other things. It could be a sort of more complex thing where your resistance and capacitance are actually going through transistors themselves. Okay, we will look at examples of that later. My point is, such a circuit is, at least I would just want to motivate the problem that such circuits can be fairly common. Okay, so even though we are talking about digital circuits over here, the reality is they are a complex network of resistances and capacitances. Okay, the question is, under these circumstances, how do I define, for example, the delay from here to here? Okay. So we will stop here for now. We will look at this tomorrow, and after this is done, we will then move on to the problem of actually looking at how a inverter can be constructed and how it works.